Good evening, everyone. Welcome, if it's your first time here, a very special welcome. If you've not been here in a while, also a very special welcome to both Partick and Glasgow City Free Churches worshipping together. Our prayer meeting is 2:30 here in person, and Kenny Boyd is the new interim moderator. If anyone wishes to be a communicant member, so taking vows, being part of the body, officially bearing with each other in our needs, you can discuss that with any elder. So talk to me and I can direct you to one. City groups, we start on Wednesday at 7:30 in Bear's Den in the West End, South Side, and also here in Partick. There won't be a Zoom element, but I would very much encourage you, if you can, to get plugged into the discipleship that happens in these churches. Our call to worship comes from Ephesians 1, 3 through 6. And the reason I chose Ephesians was I was preaching in Campbelltown recently, and Callum, the elder there, was advertising a prayer letter talking about people who had been converted on the road to Ephesus, like today. And we are talking about a letter that was written thousands of years ago to Christians in Ephesus. Ephesians chapter 1, 3 through 6. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him. In love, he predestined us for adoption as sons through Jesus Christ, according to the promise of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace with which he has blessed us in the beloved. Let's turn our call to worship to prayer. Let's pray together. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you that you have blessed us, your people, through the Lord Jesus Christ with every spiritual blessing. Thank you for choosing us while we were still enemies, and we are now sons and daughters of you. We praise you for Christ and the grace you pour upon us. In Jesus Christ's name, amen. Let us continue in adoration to God by singing Psalm 147, 1 through 7. Sing Psalms. Verse 3, he heals the broken hearts. And verse 6, he sustains the meek. Let's stand and remain standing for our opening prayer. let's unite our hearts in prayer together. Let's pray. Our Lord and King, we come before you in adoration, worship, and praise. You are the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, King of kings and Lord of lords. We know that being here in your presence is a gift, and we praise you for blessing us with the opportunity to intentionally worship you here as your gathered church together. Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. For the Lord is the great God, the great King above all gods. Come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are his people of his pasture, under the flock of his, under his care. We thank you, Lord, for your word, which you have given us, so we can wonder at the love you have for your covenantal people. Let us never lose that wonder and that joy. We thank you for Christ, his incarnate life, coming to this earth, living perfectly, teaching us your will, suffering, even dying on a cross to bring your people who are lost and wandering back to you. You came not to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. We repent now, Lord, of our sin, our selfishness, our greed, our lack of love for our fellow man, never mind our fellow believers. Work grace in us to help us live more like you every day, Lord. Help us to fulfill your commands. Help us love the Lord our God with all our hearts, minds, and strength, and love our neighbors as ourselves. We praise you as you are great. We pray our worship is acceptable to you. In Jesus Christ's name, amen. Please be seated. I think we have our catechism next. I apologize if this is at all inappropriate, but I'd like to also mention that I have my presbytery oral exam on Tuesday, which is to do with the Westminster Catechism. So I would love if my church family could hold me up in prayer. It's on Tuesday at 1:30 here. But let's look at this catechism that reflects some of what we've just prayed about. I'll ask the question and together we'll answer. What is the essence of the Ten Commandments? The essence of the Ten Commandments is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, all our soul, all our strength, and with all our mind, and to love everyone else as we love ourselves. We're going to sing once more. Jehovah Tsidkenu is a hymn written by Robert Murray McCheyne and goes through the personal testimony of not caring about God to God becoming everything. Let's stand to sing this hymn to our benefit and to God's praise.
Oh,
Our first reading this evening comes from Psalm 43 and the whole psalm. Psalm 43, reading from verse 1. Vindicate me, O God, and defend my cause against an ungodly people. From the deceitful, an unjust man, deliver me. For you are the God in whom I take refuge. Why have you rejected me? Why do I go about mourning because of the oppression of the enemy? Send out your light and your truth. Let them lead me. Let them bring me to your holy hill and to your dwelling. Then I will go to the altar of God, to my God, exceedingly joy. And I will praise you with the lyre, O God, my God. Why are you downcast, O my soul? Why are you in turmoil within me? Hope in God, for I shall again praise him, my salvation and my God. Our second reading, and what we will preach from this evening, is in Judges 6, 11 through 35. Before we read our reading in Judges, let me set some context. Moses led the Israelites out of Egypt. God parted the Red Sea. They wandered in the desert for 40 years. The Israelites sinned. Moses sinned. And for that reason, they weren't allowed to enter into the promised land, apart from Joshua and Caleb, as they never had any doubt in God and his ability to win. Joshua leads the conquest of Canaan. There's success, yet not totally, and Canaanite worship continues in the land. Judges 2, the people did evil in the sight of the Lord and worshipped the Baals. Then in the book of Judges, we have the cycle of people crying out, sinning, people then crying out to God after being oppressed, and then God raising a judge to save the nation of Israel. And then the cycle starts again and again. And we find ourselves with Gideon. Chapter 6, reading from verse 11. Now the angel of the Lord came and sat under the terebinth at Ophrah, which belonged to Joash, the Abizarite, while his son Gideon was beating out wheat in the winepress to hide it from the Midianites. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him and said to him, "The Lord is with you, O mighty man of valor." And Gideon said to him, "Please, sir, if the Lord is with us, why then has all this happened to us? And where are all his wonderful deeds that our fathers recounted to us, saying, 'Did not the Lord bring us up from Egypt?' But now the Lord has forsaken us and given us into the hand of Midian." And the Lord turned to him and said, "Go in this might of yours and save Israel from the hand of Midian. Did not I send you?" And he said to him, "Please, Lord, how can I save Israel? Behold, my clan is the weakest in Manasseh, and I am the least in my father's house." And the Lord said to him, "But I will be with you, and you shall strike the Midianites as one man." And he said to him, If now I have found favor in your eyes, then show me a sign that it is you who speak with me. Please do not depart from here until I come to you and bring out my present and set it before you." And he said, "I will stay till you return." So Gideon went into his house and prepared a young goat and unleavened cakes from an ephah of flour. The meat he put in a basket, and the broth he put in a pot, and brought them to him under the terebinth, and presented them. And the angel of God said to him, "Take the meat and the unleavened cakes, and put them on this rock, and pour the broth over them." And he did so. Then the angel of the Lord reached out the tip of the staff that was in his hand, and touched the meat and the unleavened cakes. And fire sprang up from the rock and consumed the meat and the unleavened cakes. And the angel of the Lord vanished from his sight. Then Gideon perceived he was the angel of the Lord. And Gideon said, "Alas, O Lord God, for now I have seen the angel of the Lord face to face." But the Lord said to him, "Peace be to you. Do not fear, you shall not die." Then Gideon built an altar there to the Lord and called it, "The Lord is Peace." To this day it stands at Ophrah, which belongs to the Abizzites. That night the Lord said to him, "Take your father's bull and the second bull, 7 years old, and pull down the altar of Baal that your father has, and cut down the Asherah that is beside it, and build an altar to the Lord your God on top of the stronghold here, with stones laid in due order. Then take the second bull and offer it as a burnt offering with the wood of the Asherah that you shall cut down." So Gideon took 10 men of his servants and did as the Lord had told him. But because he was too afraid of his family and the men of the town to do it by day, he did it by night. When the men of the town rose early in the morning, behold, the altar of Baal was broken down and the Asherah beside it was cut down. And the second bull was offered on the altar that had been built. And they said to one another, "Who has done this thing?" And after they had searched and inquired, they said, "Gideon, the son of Joash, has done this thing." The men of the town said to Joash, "Bring out your son that he may die, for he has broken down the altar of Baal and cut the Asherah beside it." But Joash said to all who stood against him, "Will you contend for Baal, or will you save him? Whoever contends for him shall be put to death by morning, for he is a god. If he is a god, let him contend for himself, because his altar has been broken down." Therefore, on that day, Gideon was called Jerubbaal, that is to say, "Let Baal contend against him, because he has broken down his altar." Now the Midianites and the Amalekites and the people of the east came together and crossed the Jordan and encamped in the valley of Jezreel. But the Spirit of the Lord clothed Gideon, and he sounded the trumpet, and the Abizzites were called out to follow him. And he sent messengers throughout all Manasseh, and they were too called out to follow him. And he sent messengers to Asher, Zebulon, and Naphtali, and they went out to meet him. Amen, and bless the word of the Lord to our souls. Let's unite our hearts in prayer as one body of believers. Let's pray. Our sovereign Lord, you sympathize with us because you are a great high priest who does sympathize with us in our weaknesses. A bruised reed you shall not break. We have so much to be thankful for. Our church is filled with life, and we have lots of children running around after the service. Thank you for the cries of our babies during our services. We have needs. You know them. Everything we need, you know before we ask. Yet you delight in us praying to you, our Lord, King, and wonderful Counselor. We pray for Dunblane and Alan Shearer, and we pray for him and the gospel work he undertakes there. We pray for our neighbouring congregations in Downvale and Christchurch Annie'sland. Be with those preaching today. We pray that the hearts of everyone in those congregations are encouraged in gospel hope today. We pray for our teenagers. Be with them. Let them grow in faith. Help them ask questions and give us grace in answering them. If our faith is flickering, give us the faith of a mustard seed that can move mountains, Lord. We pray for those among us going through medical treatment. Strengthen them. Be close to them. We pray for our grieving. We pray for the service that's going to happen this evening. Give them the blessing of your peace that can only come from you. We thank you. We do not grieve like those who have no hope. We pray that you are with Ross as he moves and starts a new job in London. We thank you for the blessing he has been to our congregation. Be with our rulers, bring people in power to salvation, and help them to rule justly. We leave everything in your eternal loving hands, Lord. We pray all this in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Before we approach God's word, let us once more sing to him, singing Psalm 23, from Sing Psalms, verses 1 through 6, and which very much follows our theme of God saving. Let's stand to sing. As we come to the word of the Lord, let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you that it was written thousands of years ago, yet still penetrates our hearts and our souls. We pray that your spirit is our teacher and our director. Fill our hearts with encouragement of the saving work that your son has done on the cross. And we pray that all glory is ascribed to you. In Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Have you ever been overwhelmed? It may be nothing emotionally draining, but yet just the sheer scale of practical tasks set before you. Or there might be something currently or recently that seems overwhelming, tiring, and stressful in your life. Whatever it may be, or even if everything has been free and easy, there's always a chance that some life circumstance will change that leads to a situation like that. Let's look tonight at a character study of Gideon and see what answers lie within the passage, which you never know might speak into what you're going through or what you could go through in this ever-changing life. We could spend multiple Sundays exhaustively looking at this topic. But in this one-off sermon, we will focus on three points. First, God equips the unlikely. Second, God saves. And third, and this does come with a spoiler alert, Gideon fails, Christ prevails. First, God equips the unlikely. We've set the general background of Judges, but what of Gideon and his immediate community that he lives in? As said, the book of Judges, along with a vast majority of what is still to come from the Old Testament, can be summed up in the phrase from Judges 2:11, after the death of Joshua. The people of Israel did what was evil in the sight of the Lord and served the Baals. However, there is hinted in this text an opportunity for this not to have been the immediate result here. There has just been a circuit breaker in the spiritual well-being of Israel. They've just had rest and peace for 40 years after Deborah and Barak judged the land. Chapter 5 is a song of worship about God's deliverance, and verse 31 finishes with, "But your friends be like the sun as he rises in his might," reflecting Israel. This is an opportunity to break this cycle that we've seen in Judges. This can be seen in the most minute of details in the text. In chapters 3:12 and 4:1, the language used was, "And again they did what was evil in the sight of the Lord." Like there's an inevitability. But here in chapter 6, the text says, the people of Israel did, not again, did what was evil in the sight of the Lord. The potential for a new era of Yahweh worship and perpetual relative peace was not taken up by the people of Israel. They, even in the face of God's great blessing, still turned to their own design and living on their own terms. But that should not be a moment to say, "Oh, bad Israelites." Because who here doesn't come and hear the wonders of God's kingdom every Sunday, but yet in the week fall into sin? Let it be a warning for us, not an opportunity for pride. This again is the Israel of Gideon's day, even Gideon's very own house. If we look at verse 13, Gideon speaks of how his fathers recounted wonderful deeds of God. But by verse 25, his father looks like he's changed from an elder who speaks the word of the Lord to that of a priest of Baal, with an altar residing in his own property. Along with the severe reaction of the people in verse 30, it's likely that that was a worship center. What then of Gideon the man? His story is significant. By verses alone, it's the longest story within Judges, along with the fact that there's so much direct communication that exists in the narrative between Gideon and God. However, his story does have a humble start. He's a result of nature and nurture, his nature being that of a fallen man, his nurture being raised in a family of idol worship and in a society that faced 7 years of war, not even war, but almost annihilation. Gideon is our unlikely hero. When we see his introduction, alarm bells might sound. Is this our hero, we ask? When I think of unlikely heroes, the first thing that jumps to my mind is the hobbits of the Lord of the Rings. They are so small in stature and so insignificant in the world in which they inhabit, yet they are key characters in that land's redemption arc. There's something that draws us to those stories, and I don't think it's merely a desire for the underdog, but the understanding that it reflects biblical storylines. God chooses and equips the unlikely, and God is glorified in their and in our weaknesses. Back to Gideon. We find Gideon in a winepress, verse 11, to hide the little grain he has from the Midianites. As in chapter 6, verses 1 through 7, we hear of the Midianites devouring all the Israelites have like locusts. So Gideon is hiding, beating his grain underground. Normally, this task would be done outside. You'd throw up the grain and the wind would take away the chaff. If you were to close your eyes, you might even be able to viscerally see and feel that chaff-filled air filling Gideon's lungs. Is this hiding man going to be the unlikely hero that saves Israel. Then we come to the heart of Gideon's story and his call. You've heard of a character arc. With Gideon, it's more like a character arch. You must go up, and it's going to go down. The angel of the Lord appears to Gideon in verse 12. The Lord is with you, O mighty man of valor. Gideon is incensed, responding by questioning God's will and his goodness and allowing the oppression of the Midianites. Then things go on to escalate. The Lord is not put off by Gideon's impudence. He has work to do with him. Look at the text, verse 14. But the Lord turned to him. Save Israel, did I not send you? Gideon's bravado crumbles. Is this truly a real prophet? What have I said? His response changes from impotence to fear. His response resembles the excuses made by Saul in 1 Samuel 9:21, when he's being approached to be king, and Moses at the burning bush in Exodus 3:11, when he's being asked to rescue the Israelites. Verse 15 in chapter 6. My clan is the weakest, and I am the least. God is untroubled by this. It's not a problem if Gideon has a low opinion of his stature. This is the kind of man God can work with after all. 2 Corinthians 12:9. But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly of my weakness, so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Philippians 4:13. I can do all things through him that strengthens me. In the next section, God calls Gideon to action. He calls him to make a stand against idolatry, against his family, and his people, by taking down the altar that resides in his father's house. Then using the stones and the wood of those altars to sacrifice to Yahweh instead. He then, when he succeeds in this, is given the name Jerubbaal, meaning let Baal contend against him, verse 32. After this, the Lord does confirm his call and equips him in verse 34. By the Spirit of the Lord, clothing Gideon. Now, Gideon has changed vastly in a short period of time. Now, with this divine empowerment, he calls Israel to him and can stand for the Lord on the battlefield. He's also held up in the Hall of Faith in Hebrews 11:32, along with the likes of Abraham and Moses. It should not be a surprise that God uses and chooses to equip the unlikely. It's a beautiful truth, though, that should bring hope. Does this not encourage us? Would we not see ourselves as unlikely instruments to be used by God? But he calls us and he equips us. Yes, not to be a judge of Israel, but to love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, and strength, and to love your neighbors as yourself. How? God gives us the same spirit of Jesus that empowered Gideon. Praise the Lord for his spirit that helps us to be changed, to become more like Christ. So, God equips the unlikely. What about God saving? Let's pick up where we left in Gideon's call. Our second point, God saves. Looking at verse 16, and the Lord said to him, but I will be with you, and you shall strike the Midianites as one man. This verse holds these three chapters together. No matter what attitude and loyalty man has towards God, whether in the good or in the bad, God is consistent. His steadfast love never has been and never will change towards his people. I will be with you. The angel of the Lord appeared in the interaction with Gideon back in verse 12. The Lord, Yahweh, the covenantal name of the Lord, is with you. Then in verse 16, I will be with you. God then saves Gideon from his own fear. After realizing who he's speaking to and fearing immediate death, God speaks to him gently in verse 23. Peace be to you. Do not fear. You shall not die. It's not a passing comment. This peace is tangible. My father spoke of that peace on Wednesday. It's a grace given by God. Psalm 29:11. May the Lord give strength to his people. May the Lord bless his people with peace. Isaiah 26:3. You keep him in perfect peace with whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts in you. Isaiah 26:12. O Lord, you will ordain peace for us, for you have indeed done this for all us and all our works. John 14:27, Jesus speaking, peace I leave you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives, do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. And 2 Thessalonians 3:16, now may the Lord of peace himself give you peace at all times and every way. The Lord be with you all. He is the God of peace. In that time and moment, Gideon knew it. One commentator says, now God is everything and Gideon is nothing, except a profoundly grateful human being in the midst of war and devastation, anger, frustration, self-doubt, and threatening future, which is still there, he has peace. God will save his people militarily out of their distress. But first, he cares for Gideon and he saves him from his fear. Is this not important for us? We, being followers of God, this same God who set his love upon us. And I will never tire of making this point. He is the same God we read here saving the Israelites, is the same, our same God and King. Let us, in our distress, turn to God in prayer. A God who inclines his ear to us and asks for the peace of God to be lavished upon us when we are downtrodden and when we're confused. A Father who loves giving good gifts. Matthew 7:11. How much more will your Father who is in heaven give good things to those who ask him? Gideon is saved from his fear and builds an altar named the Lord is Peace. God is promised to save by his hand. Where else in this Gideon narrative is the concept of God saving most prominent? Gideon then goes on to test God in verses 36 through 40. But he says in verse 36, if you save Israel by my hand, as you have said. Finally, Gideon has clicked. God saves through Gideon being his earthly agent on this occasion. In 2018, Hannah and I, with the assistance of our loving families, bought the house that we now live in. But to buy a house, we had to have a letter saying that the bank would front us 90% of the cost of our home. even though we did buy our house, and we, if we fill in any insurance document, we will tick the box owned with a mortgage. In reality, we didn't. The bank did. The people selling us their house didn't trust us to buy it, but the bank, that they had the financial clout to prop up the deal. Gideon looked like he bought the house. He was the military general who would stand on the battlefield and lead the Israelites to victory. But in reality, God bought the metaphorical house. It was his vast, almighty power that would win the day for Gideon and the Israelites. In chapter 7, verse 2 says, "The Lord said to Gideon, 'The people with you are too many for me to give the Midianites into their hand, lest Israel boast over me, saying, my own hand has saved me.'" We found out in verse 3 of that same chapter that Gideon's manpower was almost 32,000 men. However, in verse 12 in that same chapter, we hear the composition of the enemy force. Reading verse 12, "And the Midianites and the Amalekites and all the people of the east lay along the valley like locusts in abundance, and their camels were without number as the sand that is on the seashore in abundance." Even if the full complement that Gideon had, it would still be a miraculous victory for God, showing that God saves, but with man, there is always the opportunity for boasting. In the 1980s, a study was conducted to try and understand the mentality of drivers regarding road accidents. There were 520 participants. They were all asked to self-assess their driving ability. Only 5 of the 520 said that they were worse than average. Less than 1%, with some saying they're as good, but most saying they are a lot better than other drivers. It is described in this article as mass delusion that rendered them blind to their own failings and at a greater risk of road accidents. Also, in the research for this part of the sermon, I read an article that spoke of how to promote yourself on social media by staying on that fine line before boasting. Humans have a natural inclination to boast, and the Israelites are no different. It cannot come to pass that that idolatrous Israelite nation take the esteem for God's victory for themselves. How then is this stopped? To offset that outcome, God reduces the fighting force down to 22,000, and then down again to 300, making it beyond any doubt that it is God who saves and it will be God's victory. Then God wins the battle for Gideon. Chapter 7, verse 22. "When they blew the 300 trumpets, the Lord set every man's sword against his comrade and against all the army. The Lord set every man against each other, as Gideon predicts in verse 2. God saves. He says he'll save. He will. And he does. So, God has chosen the unlikely in Gideon, and we take solace in that. Then God saves, and we have assurance in that. Everything seems to be going well. Okay, our hero still remains unlikely, but there's faith, there's growth, and God's victory. What about our third point? Gideon fails. Christ prevails. If you're anything like me, I am not a fan of a film that ends badly for everyone. There's no closure. Two that jump to mind are Troy and The Perfect Storm, showing a bit of my film knowledge. For various reasons, and I won't spoil them, everything ends on a sad note. This is much like Gideon's story here. Where does Gideon's story go awry? First, he's gone from a humble, faithful warrior into a savage general. In chapter 7:24, he calls for the rest of Israel to arms to rout the Midianites. But he comes to two bordering towns, Succoth and Peniel. The men of these towns decide against assisting in the campaign, because if it goes wrong, they are very much in the firing line. Gideon curses them. And after capturing the Midianite kings, he returns to serve his form of justice. In verses 16 and 17, he flogs the men of Succoth, but goes further to execute capital punishment on all the men of Peniel. Gideon's leadership is fracturing Israel, but uniting it together. It's also seen in the fact that even though Gideon acts correctly in rejecting the offer of kingship from his people in chapter 8, verse 23, Gideon said to them, "I will not rule over you, and my son will not rule over you. The Lord will rule over you." Then, just after one of the best moments, comes his fall in drastic contrast. The Gideon of chapter 6, 24 goes from making an altar to God's praise. But here, all the praise and adulation is reserved for Gideon himself. He commands a gold tribute from his people in verse 24, then erects a golden ephod, a statue to his stature placed prominently in his city. Like other idols before it, it becomes a case of heart worship for Gideon and his family, verse 27. Also, he has rejected kinship, but in the text, it's very clear he goes on to very much live like Israelite kings. He has many wives and at least one concubine. That concubine, he has Abimelech, whose name means son of the king. Gideon dies. Just like Gideon, a story of kindling faithfulness that wanes. The people, after he dies, as a whole, whore after the Baals once again, making them their God and forgetting their one and only true God. Chapter 8, verse 33. Now, the point in this is not to say Gideon is written off. As we've noted earlier, he is in the hall of faith within Hebrews. He is a man, but he is a flawed man. At points, he did better than others. He led Israel, and they did experience rest for 40 years. The point in this section is to do what the Old Testament does as a whole, and pointing us to Christ, especially at this point in time, looking forward to the Messiah. Where Gideon failed, living like a king, Christ prevailed. When he was in the desert, overcoming temptations, he was offered everything he could see, but he resisted the devil's offer. When Gideon felt wronged by the people of Succoth and Peniel, he failed, lashing out in anger. When Christ was wronged in the garden and Peter struck out in violence against a servant, Jesus said in Luke 22:51, "No more of this." And he touched his ear and healed him. Gideon failed. Christ prevailed in love. When Gideon died, all the people returned to their idolatry and didn't care for his family. When Christ died, he reconciled an elect from every generation to eternal life. Romans 5, verse 6. "For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly." Romans 5, 15. "But the free gift is not like the trespass. For if many died through one man's trespass, much more have the grace of God by the free gift, by grace that one man, Jesus Christ, abounded for many." Romans 14, 15. "For to this end Christ died and lived again, that he might be the Lord of both the dead and of the living." Gideon failed. Christ prevailed. This is your hope if you follow Jesus Christ as your Lord and saviour, friend and brother. He has died for you. You are secure. He has prevailed to save the elect of which you are among. Is Christ Jesus your saviour? Go away from this place with thankfulness and joy in your heart tonight. Christ has prevailed. If you're here, though, and have never heard about Christ before, or if you've heard about him all your life and not given your life to him, hear this. Christ has prevailed. You are here tonight for this purpose. Hear the love of God for you. If you have clicked onto YouTube today, it is for this purpose. Hear the love of God for you today. Give your life to Christ now. Do not wait a moment longer. That thankfulness and joy that we share can be yours too, as Christ has prevailed for you. God equips the unlikely, just as well as we are all unlikely. God saves. Everyone he has intended to save, he did, and he will. Praise God. Gideon failed. We fail. But there is good news, because Christ prevailed. Amen, and bless that word to us. Let's turn to that saving God in prayer. We thank you, Lord, that you are a God who saves his people, who set his love upon us. We pray for the people of Glasgow to hear your gospel, to turn to you so that more voices are praising your name. We know that we fail. We know that Gideon failed. We are so thankful that Christ prevailed and always will prevail because he did. We pray that you are glorified because you are all glorious and worthy of all glory, honor, and praise. In Jesus Christ's name, amen. Let's respond and celebrate Christ prevailing and singing, and the hope that we have in singing the hymn Grace, and remain standing for the benediction. Let's stand to sing to our God. Let's close our service reading 1 Peter 2, 9 through 10. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. Amen.